Today we are gonna talk about an introduction to C. So we are gonna talk how the C in general works. I mean the compilation steps and how can we create a C program from scratch. And we will learn about the steps that we are gonna write down a simple C program with an example. Now, first of all, in writing C, we must use a text editor, okay, to create the model files. But it was so in maybe 20 years ago. Nowadays, we don't use a text editor, but we are using an integrated development environment. Shortly, we called it IDE. Okay, IDE. So integrated development environment in which there is a text editor for you to edit your source code. I will show you in a moment. Okay, so what is the code? Code is the instructions written in some programming language. So we are learning C. So code actually is a instruction. Okay, instruction in for us C programming language. And what is a source code? Actually, source code is that code together written in a text editor or a text file. So in a text file, we are put to some instructions, which are valid in C, okay? In a text file, okay? In a text file. I think it's clear. So it's called source code. So you can open a source code with, for example, Notepad. Okay, and you can check the source code because source code is just a text written in C language. Now, a file containing source code is called source file. So when you write a text, for example, you save to the hard disk. Now, when you save the source code into a file giving a name, now it becomes the source file. And in C, the source file, the extension, you know that most of the files, for example, my presentation dot ppt, right? Ppt. So ppt is the extension for that file name, okay, showing the type of the file. So in the source code, so my C dot, for example, is always C extension, okay? And you are gonna learn when you are gonna second grade 2 to 5 course, you are gonna learn C++, okay? Then in that course, you are gonna see that your code, for example, C++ source code file will behave C++ extension. Okay, so this is C and this is the PPT are the file extensions. So you have to submit your homeworks in that extension, okay? You have to submit your source file with that dot C extension. It is really important. Don't provide C++ files, okay? So you have to provide the SC source code. I think it's clear. Now, after a C source file has been created, the programmer must invoke the C compiler before program can be executed. Now, what is a C compiler? First of all, it is a part of the integrated development environment. It's a part of, so let's say that it's the integrated development environment. This is the part A, a text editor. This is the part B, which is a compiler. So every compile languages has some compiler for you. So C needs to be compiled to before run it. Okay. How can you run the compile file? So this is actually part C of a integrated development environment by clicking the execute it. Or after the compilation, we will end up this file, okay, as my C dot executable exe. So this extension solves the operating system that it can be run by the operating system. So either you can use the run command in the integrated development environment, or you can open by your file browser and you just click over it, myexe, and it will be run. So that's the whole idea. Do you have any questions for that? The basic idea. You use a text editor to write the C code. When you put the everything in the C code into one C file, so it's gonna be source code. So when you save the source code, you now have the source file, but you cannot run the source file, which is a .c extension. You need to first to compile it, and then you need to run it. When you compile it, you will just convert myc to myc.exe. Then you can run it by using the integrated development environment, or you just click over the my.exe. Okay, so I will clear everything and I will continue. Now, here what you see is the stage one for pre-processing. Here in this, the pre-processing, okay, this is the step one, pre-processing. How many steps we have? In general, we have three states or three phases for a compilation. What we are gonna do, remember that actually at the stage zero, let me put it stage zero. Okay, you already write the source code. You already write the source code. Then stage one, you are ready to pre-processing. Okay, so we are gonna use a special software, preprocessor, and preprocessor is the part D of the integrated development environment. So actually, integrated development environment is the collection of several softwares. This is the fourth software we are mentioning right now. So this software will take your source code or source file as an input, and it will do something on your source code in the fly. So in the fly means that the processor will not change your source code at all, but whatever it does on the fly. Okay, now it modifies the source code in RAM, not in the hard disk. Okay, according to preprocessor directives, we are gonna come to that points, directives, okay, or preprocessor commands embedded in this source code. So in the source code, we are gonna put some preprocessor commands, directives. We are telling that processor do this and don't do this on my source code. It will do these instructions on the source code in the RAM, not in the hard disk, okay? Not in the hard disk. So in the hard disk, the source code will still stay intact. Okay. Now, it also strips the commands. I am going to explain the commands in a moment. And white spaces. So what is a white space? So white space, actually you can put two spaces here. One of them is white space. You don't need actually, okay. From the code. The source code is stored on the disk, is not modified as I mentioned. All right. So this is the what preprocessor do. So let me put here, a preprocessor is a software. It takes your source code or source code file as an input. Okay. It outputs the cleaned version or let me put here, okay, a preprocessed version of your source code. But this source code is actually on the hard disk, and this is on the RAM. So preprocessor does not change anything on the hard disk, but it prepares your source code, the text code in the RAM. Now we are gonna go and we are gonna build in the next step. I will explain the next step. Do you have any questions? Okay, now this is the second steps. I will clear everything. So what we have the first step, remember that in the stage zero, we have the source code. In the stage one, we provide the source code to the preprocessor. Preprocessor return a clean version of the source code in the RAM. Now we have at the stage two, the compilation. So we are gonna use a software called compiler. Remember that this is the part C, I think, in a integrated development environment. It's just a software. So this software takes the output of the preprocessor out of the preprocessor here in the RAM. It takes and translates the object code or machine code, not machine language. Machine code, not machine language. Machine code. So it's called object code. So remember what we have done here. Now we have write my C.C file provided to the preprocessor. Preprocessor return it and preprocessed in the RAM. In the RAM. Okay, not in the hard disk. And now compiler takes this. This is the compiler. Okay. And writes it to the hard disk. To the hard disk, not anymore in the RAM. The same name, my C dot, but now the extension is O, which is object code. Now, remember that my C can be written by a notepad because it's a text format. Now, this object code is not text anymore. It's not text. You cannot open and see inside, but it is a binary. So what is a binary? Binary means that zero or one are only the elements in that format. So you cannot use some words, some statements in English, in Turkish, whatever, but you have to use only one or zeros to symbolize whatever you need to store. So you cannot open and look it into the text. So that's the simple idea, but of course it's not so simple, it's complex, but for the moment it's enough to understand. So that's what the compilation does, but actually more than this, that's the result. But what it does inside the compiler, let's see that. First, it checks the syntax errors. So what is a syntax error? So remember that in English, for example, let me say that every statement should begin with a capital letter. And if you don't do this, if you begin with a sentence in English with a lowercase, your English teacher will correct this because it's a syntax error. So syntax error means that if you don't obey the rules, if you don't obey the rules, your mistakes are called syntax errors. So syntax means related with the grammar rules of the language. So syntax rules are related with the grammar of the language. And remember, we are using a programming language. So it is still a language. You have to understand its grammar. If you do something wrong in the grammar rules, the compiler will create syntax errors or sometimes warnings. Okay, so that's the main idea, what the compiler does. The second thing, saves the object code to a disk file. I already explained. If instructed to do so, and most of the time, yes, we can do this or not do this. I will show this. If any compiler errors are received, so if there is an error, so these errors are syntax errors. We need to look at the grammar of what we have written, and we need to compare the rules of C, and we need to correct it in the source code. Okay, then we need to again, so if there is a fix, if you correct some errors, unit D again pre-process it and then compile it again. If there is no errors, of course, we will see the next step what we are gonna with the object code. So pay attention to the compiler messages. Any questions? All right. Now this is the stage three. So let me remind you, in the stage zero, we already write the source code. We save the source code in a source file in the hard disk. And this name is myc.c. And step one, what we have done, we have used the preprocessor software to process the myc and produce some preprocessed version of the my code, source code in RAM. And in stage two, we use the compiler, and compiler takes the preprocessed source code in RAM, check for the errors, grammar errors, syntax errors. Then if there is no error, it produced some executable file in the hard disk drive, and which is the name is myc.exe with the extension exe. All right. Now here we have the stage three. Now we have the executable part of the compiler. But actually what we do is that to create the executable, we need to some more steps, which is linking. Most of the time linking is hidden inside the stage two. So to be honest, most of you will experience that you are not gonna be aware of the linking at all. But I have to make it clear that normally in stage two, we don't create the executable HDD at once. Here, it's not like that. We cannot create the executable in stage two. Normally, after the stage two, we are gonna use the linker. Linker, where is linker? Here I will put another software. Linker is another software in C, and which is a part of integrated development environment. And linker will take the output of the stage two, actually, which is still an object code. Okay. And then, okay, create the executable. I will show in a moment that you are not gonna be aware of that because it's gonna be done automatically in most of the integrated development environment, but you need to know this because we are gonna use these concepts in our future courses. Okay, so we are gonna use that object file, myc object file, after compile and at the linking. So what it does? So we have the program object code after the compiler actually. And object code, we need to make it the executable file. Okay, the object codes, there could be many object codes. Let me explain you something. Here, assume that you are gonna write a C program in the end, C executable, okay. And in the C executable, for example, you want to show something to the user in a window, and you want to have some button here for clicking, for example, okay button. And you know that users can use some mouse, okay, as an input to the computer, okay. But how can you handle all these things? I mean a button, the mouse, clicking, right? How can you all handle all these things from scratch? Normally, you need to write every possible code for handling all this. So you need to write a mouse driver to handle the mouse driver. You have to write a screen driver to understand. It's impossible to do from scratch. What we use, somebody already written some code for you. For example, handling the mouse, Some other guy already written some other code for handling the screen and so on. There are lots of codes written and these are called libraries. Libraries. So in the dev libraries, these codes are already written for you and compiled. And they come with you, okay, with the C programming language together. They are bundled together. So when you need to handle the mouse, you don't need to write this from scratch, your own code. You don't need to. But what you do, you will select the one library and add to your code. So that programming, you can write programs very fast by using somebody else's libraries. Okay. I will come to this point 13 weeks later. Okay, 13 weeks later. But for the moment, it is enough. You should understand that when you write your code, you are not only using your code, but you are using somebody else's code, and this code is called libraries. You need to use these libraries in your code to make your code simple and run, improves running time faster. All right, this is the idea. So we have some codes already used in our object code, okay? But they are in their libraries. What we have to do? This is our object code. These are the libraries. We have to combine all of them into one code so that this code can be executable on the CPU. Okay, it can be runnable. Therefore, what we are gonna do, we need to integrate our object code with the libraries. That's what the linker does. So linker takes your object code and takes the necessary libraries from runtime libraries or other libraries, put together as a one file. So this in the Linux system is extensions out, but in Windows it is executable. Now we have reached the executable. I think it is clear so far. Do you have any questions? Do you have any questions? No. Okay. I will clear. Now, here is the summary for all. Please pay attention because it's the gonna be the summary. So, as a programmer, you are the programmer. Okay. You are the programmer. You develop the algorithm. Okay. And you write the algorithm in two ways. One is pseudocode. The other is flowchart. Now you are ready to implement your algorithm. You are ready to implement your algorithm. So you can distribute these algorithm to different programmers. For example, you can distribute programmer one, programmer two, programmer three. Okay. Some part of the algorithm, this part, that part, that part. And each programmer will be use first the editor to write it is source file and save that source file as the program.c in the hard disk drive. Okay. And we need to pre-process this. This is another kind of software. You provide this input and it will provide that output into the RAM. So now it is modified source code. The compiler take the modified source code in the RAM. It will compile it, finding the syntax errors. If there is no syntax error, it will output the program.o file, which is a object code. Object code. Okay. Now the object code is binary, so you cannot open them in the notepad and understand. But remember that source file is text, so you can open and check it. Now, after the compiler, the linker will take that object code as input, and it will produce the executable file in Windows.exe. In Linux, it is .out. And the whole software package is called Integrated Development Environment. In the end, on the hard disk, here on the hard disk, you have a file, for example, program.exe.file. You can click on it, or in the IDE, you can just make it run. Now, I will show a simple example for that to put everything together. As I said that we are gonna use the code blocks. Okay, now let me clear everything. Here you see the code block. I will just try to show you step by step with ease, so you can open new empty file. Okay, what I am going to write is a simple preprocessing directive here. I will put a preprocessing directive here. So what I am going to say, include a library. Remember, I talk about libraries. Now I am going to use one library, which is standard input output dot hash library. Okay. And then I will try to write my simple code. First, I need to write my simple program. So I am going to use a simple function for that. And we will always use one function, always. Its name main, then we can add up many more functions if necessary. So in the main, we have to use a curly brackets to open and to close, but I can make it bigger for you. Okay, now here is that. And then I will do a very simple thing for you. Let me print F onto the screen. So it's a function, and you know that functions takes parameters in parentheses, and I will provide it a string. So I will use a double quotation mark, and I will put the message "Hello World" as a custom. Okay. Now, and then I will put a semicolon at the end. It's C rule that every statement must end up with a semicolon, and I will use another function just to make wait for me to click any other keyboard, anything on the keyboard so that it can finish. So I have to finish my function returning some integer value because I did say so, return, for example, 0. All right. Now it finishes. So far, so good. But first of all, remember that when you write a code, you have to save it first. Now, let me save file. I will save the file here. Let me say this is my C program. Let me say, okay, my C program. Here you see that it says C, C++ files. I take it C1, not C++. And I am going to save it now. Okay, I save it. I will open the location, this location, and here you see that my C is there. Now, right click, open with notepad, and here on the notepad, you see the exact code. Now, let me change something here. Let me show you. Put the double exclamation mark or triple. Okay, now let me save it. Save. And I close it. I jump over back to the code blocks. Now, code blocks reload file because it already understands. So the code block is the integrated development environment. We use it is editor right now, but I use then the notepad editor here, change the code. Now, the integrated development environment understands that I change out of the IDE. Now it gives me warning to reload it. I said yes. Now you see that that's terrible. So what I'm going to show then, I am writing in a text editor like notebook, but it's inside the code block editor. So code block integrated development environment. Now, after writing that code, remember this is the source code, and this is the source file in the hard disk. So this is the source code. Remember, that's the stage 0. Now I am ready for the stage 1. What is the stage 1? Anybody remembers? What is the stage 1? Anybody remembers? To the chat screen, please. Yes, Daniel, you are right. Pre-processing, Müslüm, you are right. Yes, Eylül, you are right. So how can we do the pre-processing? So now let me show that this is the pre-processing directive saying that include somebody else's code into my code. So this is standard input output header file, okay, written by somebody else. So this is the directive for pre-processing. And this is the command include somebody else's code in that standard input output header file. For to do this, now here we have the build option. You need to build your file. So build means that pre-process it, okay. And now here you see that it's gonna be pre-process it, all right. And then the second step is remember that compiler here, compile the current file. But as I stated that when we compile in the integrated development environment, you are not gonna be aware of the linker, but actually linker will work as a part of the compiler step. So stage two and stage three will happen here. Now, if you look at here, okay. Now, the compiler already compiles this and created the dot output. Maybe you can, difficulty to seeing that, but that's the output file. Then linker, after then, the second step, we already, after the linker, we compile it and we created the exe file. Let me show that here. Now you see that here we have the program, myc program dot output or object code. Then we have the executable code. So as I explained it, these are the stage two and three done together. Okay. You can check the build log here. Here, what happens. Now, in the, how can we run this code? In two ways. You can run here. Let me run in. Hello world. Click somewhere on the keyboard. And now it is finished. Okay. Or you can go over to the hard disk and you can click over it, double click, and then it is done. So that's the whole stage that I tried to show you. But one thing I would like to mention is that, for example, let me put here, instead of exclamation mark, let's put question mark. Now, if I run this code, what happens? On the screen, what I will see? If I click run, what I am going to see on the screen? Syntax error. Okay. Let me run and see what we have seen. Three exclamation marks. Why? Remember that this is the only source code. This is the only source code. Changing the source code does not mean that you are changing the object code and the executable code. You only change the source code. Even in that source code, I will open and show you that. Even here is the three exclamation mark. Why? Yes, Berkin, you are right. And Orkun, you are right. Müslüm, you are right. Yes, yes. Because we didn't save it yet. So remember that when you change your source code, you need to first write it down or save it to source file. Now I save it to source file. Then you need to build it. You need to compile. And then you need to run it. Now the question. Okay, now pay attention here. I will do another thing here. For example, let me put an hash. Now pay attention, pay attention. I save it. Okay, now here I compile it. Okay, now I will run it, but we are gonna see that on the screen. What we are gonna see. I save it, I'll compile it, and I'm going to run it. What I'm going to see? The question mark or the hash? The question mark or the hash? Okay, let me run it. Now we have hash. Okay. Now, normally we would end up with the actually question mark, because pay attention that here, when you only compile the current file, you are not gonna build. So it means that you are not gonna use the object code. And remember, this object code is the old one actually. But here in the compiler is so smart that, okay, if you want to use it, it will also compile the object code as well. All right. Now, I will finish that example and I would like to continue with the presentation. Okay. I will talk about the ideas here. First of all, please pay attention that I will use some terminology, and the terminology is important. So what you see here is that a programmer header command, that's called programmer header command. Command means that something written for the programmer itself. It's not for the user, it's not for the compiler. But first of all, before continuing something, I would like to make clear something. Here, I am going to talk three important roles. Three important roles. One, the first one is you. You means that you are programmer. You are writing the code. You are the programmer. Okay. The second one, I am talking about in general, compiler. I mean actually the integrated development environment, which takes the source code and produces the executable code. Okay. And the third role is important, the user. Actually, the user means that the end user. Who is the end user? Assume that you are writing a program for the secretary, department secretary. She is the end user. Okay, so who are we? We are the programmer. What we are using, a compiler or integrated development environment. For whom we are writing the code? For the end user. Do you understand these three important roles? Because I'm going to ask these roles. Now, I am asking that this is the programmer or program header command. Command. Header command. It is written for whom? It's written for whom? Programmer, compiler, the user. Yes. Yes. Bravo. Programmer. Why? Because as I said that after you design some algorithm and you write the algorithm in pseudocode or flowchart, and the parts of the algorithm you can give to programmer one, and the other part you can give to the programmer two, and they can write their own codes. But in the end, we need to merge these two codes into one. And some other programmer, for example, programmer three will do this job, but he or she needs to understand what is happening in that part of that source code. So in the source code, we need to put the comments explaining what we are gonna do to the programmer. That's the programmer. Anyone in your programming team, anyone in your software team, is that clear? So commands are for programmer. Is that clear for everyone? Okay, I will clear then everything. All right, so this is the command for the programmer. So this is the symbol that we are using, create a command. So this is the opening, this is the closing, and in between that, whatever you write here, do you think that compiler needs to know what is written here as a command? Of course, bravo, compiler does not need, because it is, you see that it's just an English and explanation to the programmer. So compiler don't care about that. So in the pre-processing step, if we are provided this source code to the pre-processing, Then preprocessing will return only this part of the code. Do you understand now what does preprocessing do? It will remove the commands not in the hardware, not in the hard disk, okay, but in the RAM. It will return, it will modify on the fly, but it will return this part to the compiler. Okay, that's the idea. Now, here we have another, what's that symbol? Any idea? What's the name of the symbol? It's not hashtag. It is just hash, Arif. It's not hashtag, the others all right. It is not, no, Saide, I am asking what is the name of that symbol? I don't ask what that symbol is used for, Saide. All right. I am asking what is that name of the symbol, okay? Not why we are using, for what reason, okay? Now, this is called hash, okay? Of course, in I think Twitter or other media, you use, for example, hash and Murat. Now Murat is a tag, and you put the hash, now it is gonna be hashtag. Do you understand? Somebody write hashtag, but itself is not hashtag. Together, it is a hashtag. I think it's clear. All right, now, it is a hash symbol. So why we use the hash symbol? Now, as it said, that it is the pre-directive. So what is a directive in English? It's an instruction, but we are saying that pre-processing directive. Why we are using hash symbol? For showing a preprocessing directive. Okay, this is the symbol. Why we use that symbol? Showing the preprocessing directive. So remember that we have the preprocessor. Preprocessor takes all the source code. Preprocessor, it's a kind of software. And it will output, change that file. First, it will remove the commands. So it will remove the, if there is any commands, it will remove. If there is the any hash, so it means that pre-processing directive, it will execute it. Here, the pre-processing directive symbol, what is the directive? What is that directive? There are many directives, but here we see that include is the directive to the pre-processing. Remember, include means that get others library, remember that's a library, another user. Get that library from the hard disk. In the hard disk, there are many libraries, remember many. We get one of them, which is name is, whose name is standard input output header file. And add this to here, because hashtag preprocessing directive symbol shows the directive, which is include. Then include takes a parameter standard input output. The preprocessor goes to the library, takes this library, add here up. So now my code will become here some code coming from that library, standard input output library here. And then here is the my integer blah 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 is here. Here. Okay. But that part is from the standard input output header file. Is that clear for everyone? What the preprocessor does? It automatically takes your all. Oh, I can clear everything. Let me. Okay. So we have the preprocessor here. Preprocessor. It takes all your source code. Okay. Takes as an input. Then removes the commands, if there is any command, you see that that's the command. Okay, command block actually, it's a block. Block means that more than one command, okay? It removes first. Then if there is a hash symbol, which is a preprocessing directive, takes care of the directive at this time it's include. standard input output, and this file stays in a hard disk in somewhere. So that will take as an input as well. And in the output, there will be first that file code. Here it, there will be the code from that file. Then my rest of the code here. Now we have the my, or here example is hello C. Now we have the hello dot O, which is object code. I think it's clear. Any questions? Okay. I will continue. Now, here you see that a keyword, okay, or reserved word. So it means that int is a part of C language. It means that integer. Okay. So what is an integer? Integer is a number without any decimal point. So I think everybody knows what is a decimal point. Huh? So integer does not decimal point. So do you think that 3.0 is an integer in C? Do you think that 3.0 is an integer in C, not in mathematics? Sabahattin, it's not mathematics. I am asking Orkun, I am asking in C. In mathematics, it's an integer, but in C it is not, because how we define the int in C? A number without a decimal point. Here we have the decimal point. Do you understand? I said that in the first week, math and C are not the same. Pay attention. We are learning C here. We are not learning math. Forget math. I am talking a new concept. In int means that integer in C. In C, the integers does not have any decimal point. Is that clear? Okay. So please memorize. What is an integer? A number without any decimal point. That's the what we are going to use all the time. Okay. Now integer. Here is the main. Main is the function name. Function name. In mathematics, we use mostly, for example, fx, right? Showing a function. So that f is the name of the function. Sometimes in mathematics, we use gx, right? So what's the name of that function? Is g. Okay, here, this is the function name. What's that function name? Main. In every C programming, there must be one and only one main function, always. Not zero, not two. Not zero, not two, not three. But one and only one main function in every C program. I think it's clear. So it is in mathematics, but here we put the function. And in mathematics, we use the parentheses showing the parameters, right? Here is the x is the parameter. So how can we show the parameter? By using the parentheses. It is in C, it is the same. So the parentheses here shows the parameter list, because there could be more than one parameter. So here. Now, what is void? Void means that not zero. Void doesn't mean zero. Void doesn't mean nothing. It does not mean nothing. Okay. It means that does not exist. Buran, you remember from last semester, I believe. Does not exist. Okay. It means does not exist. Now I am asking sen, the main function takes how many parameters? Berkin says one. I am asking again, the function main takes how many parameters? Infinitive, infinitive means millions of it. Do you see 1, 2, 3, 3, 4, 5, 6? So millions. IDK, Korea, I didn't understand IDK. As you want, no. I am asking Yusuf right now, you are seeing here. That's the program code. In that program code, the main function takes how many parameters? Zero, no, one, no, as you want, no, I don't know. Okay. So it takes, does not take any parameters. That's the answer. What does mean void means? What does void means? Void means does not exist. So your reply means that the main have no parameters. It does not have. I am not talking any return value, Cenk'in. I am asking parameters. What is a parameter in between the parentheses? Okay. So do you have any questions? Void meaning? Void means that does not exist. Your answer must always be does not exist. Not zero, not nothing. Because in C++, you are gonna see null. In data structure course, you are gonna see nil. Okay, so nil, null, void are special characters, special concepts, and they don't have equal with zero. Okay, it's very important you understand at that moment. Okay, after 4 years graduation, after 4 years when you graduate, you will understand what I am talking. Nil, null, void, zero are totally different. Okay. Now there is one question why we are writing here. We need to be specify clearly that we don't use any parameters, but you can shortly write like that as well, integer, main, and open and close the parentheses. So these are equal to each other. Okay, writing void and not writing void equals. Okay, Bahar? All right. So if you want to be clear, I can write it. But shorthand writing, you don't have to write all the time. Now, you are seeing that symbol. What is the name of that symbol? It is curly bracket or bracelet. It's the same. One in English, British English, one is in American English. Okay. Of course, you have to use always the parentheses. Huh? Do you think that's a function? F is a function, Cenk'in. Do you think that F is a function alone like that? It's not. Because F function, even it does not take anything, it must have parentheses. Okay. So I will clear. Let's continue. Now, what's that symbol? Name of that symbol? Yes, curly brackets or curly brackets, okay. Or bracelet, brackets and braced are the same. So curly means that there is a curve here or there is a curve here, okay. So that's the curly brackets here. If we need to use the curly brackets showing that that function, the main function begins here and finish here, okay. So we are gonna show where that function begins and ends. In the function body, we are gonna call this thing function body. If this is the function body, beginning and end in between, what's that part? Function. Bravo, function head. That's the function head, that's the function body. We are gonna talk about this in the 13 and 14 weeks a lot. Okay. For the moment, just keep in mind that that's part of the function head, that's the function body. So in the function head, we have the parameter list, okay, now void, function name, okay, and return data type. I will explain later. In the function body, we have all the instructions or the statements, C statements, C instructions are the same. So the commands. Okay. Now, in the first statement, we have a function again, printf. How do you understand printf is a function? How do you understand that printf is a function? How do you understand? Yes, Artun, you are right. Because we use a parenthesis after the comment. So if something here x, y, z, and then the parenthesis, you understand that x, y, z is the name of the function. And after the parenthesis, we have the parameter list always. Okay. So printf is the function. So how many parameters it has? How many parameters it has? So printf is the function name. Here is the parameter list in between the parentheses. How many parameters here? Only one. Bravo. Why only one? Because we have a double quotation mark. So this is double quotation mark. And there are a number of characters. Each of them is called character. It's not only the alphabet, but there are the symbols, space, exclamation mark, blah, blah, blah. And there are the characters, lots of characters. All of them now called string. Okay. And in between the double quotation mark, so it makes only one parameter. One parameter is given to the printf function. Actually, where is that function coming from? That function is a part of the standard input-output header file. So it knows how to put the strings onto the screen. So this function is implemented in that header file in a library. Okay. And it knows how to print out its parameter onto the screen. That's the function printf. All right. So the function printf takes only one parameter for the moment, which is the string here. And string is consist of several characters, many characters, but in between double quotation mark, it's only one parameter. That's all. Any questions? No? Okay. Now, we are moving to that semicolon. Why we use the semicolon? For in C, each statement ends up with a semicolon. Each statement. Okay, statement. In English, each statement ends up with what? A dot or a question mark or a exclamation mark, right? But in C, you have to put for each statement, okay, you have to put a semicolon. Is that clear? Daniel, in English, it does not end up with a semicolon in English. Okay. All right. In C, it ends up with a semicolon. All right. I will clear. Now, we have the return command. It's another keyword. Now, return is a keyword or reserve word. I will explain later. You cannot use anywhere. Now, do you think that return is a function or not? Okay. Now, it's great that you are saying no, because you learned that any function should have some parameters after it. If it is a function x, y, z, it must have x, y, z. You are right. So if there is no parenthesis now, it's not going to be the function. But here there is an exception, because in real life, every program or every function, I will explain details later, mostly ends up with the return and some value, 0, 10, or whatever. Okay. So In writing a C program, you are gonna repeat most of the time this structure after most of the functions. So the compiler will provide us a shorthand writing. Instead of writing parentheses in return, you can use the return without parentheses. But it is a shorthand only for return function. Okay, because we use frequently use it, and the integrated development environment, the part of it compiler will fix it for you. If you forget to put the parentheses here, the compiler will it put you here automatically. Or remember preprocessor? Preprocessor put the parentheses for you automatically, but only for return. Okay. Only for return. All right. So I finish structure of the C programming simple, but I will repeat again for your understanding so you can follow. Here is called what, all this part. Not only comment, Daniel, because we use comments in anywhere, but it's not only comment. Okay, I will explain right now. It's an opportunity for me to explain you. Here I can put here, print a message on screen. Now, let me ask this question. What is that? What is that? Now it is just a comment. Okay, it's just a comment, okay. But what is that? What is that? It is a header comment. Header means that at the beginning of the program. So it gives the idea of the program. So it gives the idea of the function, what we are gonna do when we did this, what's the input, output, okay. So that's the idea. Now, let me move on. So what is that part? What's that part? Anybody? It does, Hüseyin, it does include input outlet, but what is that? The directive is not only right, Daniel. Head is not right. So what is that, Batuhan? I am asking that. What is that area? What's that comment? I am asking that. Preprocessive directive. It is preprocessive, preprocessing directive. No, I am not asking Cenk'er what is the reason for it. Now you have to memorize the keywords. You have to memorize the keywords. I am asking the keywords. You are trying to translate from English to English. You are explaining the concepts. Don't explain the concept. Tell me the name of that concept. The name of that concept is preprocessing directive. Preprocessing directive. Is that clear for everyone? All right. Pay attention to learn the terms. All right. Now let's move on. What's that part? What's that part? Function header. Function header. Head function is not correct, Boray. Function header or function head. All right. Both of them correct. Now let me move on. What about that part? Function body, not code block. Function code block can be all right, but I didn't explain code block right now. Okay. Function body. Bravo. Now let me ask another question. What is that part? What is that one? End of the line is not correct. Line, I never use the line keyword. Semicolon is the name of the symbol. I am not asking the name of the symbol. End of statement. Yes, end of statement. Cenk'er, I am not asking the name of the symbol. I am asking the concept. It's the end of the statement. Okay. All right. So in general, what is that? In general. In general. Printf is what kind of, yes, function. Bravo. Bravo. Now let me move on and ask this. What are these symbols are used for? Why are we using these symbols? Parameter list, not only parameters. It includes the parameter list because a list can contain more than one parameter. All right. Now let me move on. What that name of that symbols? What is the name of that symbol? What is the name of that symbol? Heading? No. Double quotation. Double quotation. All right. In double quotation, what we have? In double quotation, what we have? In double quotation, what we have here? In double quotation, what we have? String, string, string. Bravo. Okay. All right. Now let me ask another one. Why we use these curly brackets? Why we use these curly brackets? To block. I didn't this to block. Why we use to open and close the code block? Not open and close. I never use open and close. These are terminology. Okay. Yes. Start and end of the function. Start and end of the function body. Now it's correct. Okay. So an idea why we use, for example, return statement. An idea why we use return statement. An idea why we use return statement. An idea why we use start statement. To return the function. In either ending the function. Mm-hmm. Sync everything okay to operating system. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. There are several good answers. For the moment, of course, this is, we are gonna take care of the functions later. For the moment, it is good you understand all of these concepts for the moment. Do you have any questions? The parts of a simple C program. So that's the C program, simple C program. But I explain everything. If you understand these concepts, we are gonna talk about 13 weeks about all of them in details, of course. So may I continue? May I continue? Now I will go very quickly over the slides because I already cover all of them. Please look at the slides. If you have any problem, tell me. Otherwise, I will move on and I will let you go by yourself. So I already explained the command. I will go over quickly, very quickly. Okay. We talk about command. We use that symbol, open and close the block command. These are called command delimiters. Okay. If I can use. We talk about preprocessing directives. include standard input output as a example. We talk about the hash symbol. We talk about include directive. We talk about the libraries. Libraries are written by somebody else to help us. Okay, we add the libraries to our code. So the preprocessor takes care of the adding these libraries to our source code. Okay. So every program must have a function called main. So main function must be at least one and maximum one time. So there couldn't be two main functions, but every program has one, exactly one main function. Okay. And remember that the function parameters are in between parentheses. We understand something is a function because of that parentheses. And we have the reserved word int indicates that integer value. And integer value means that a number without a decimal point. So a number, for example, 3.0 is not a integer in C. So we talk about a void means nothing is there. So it means that does not exist. Okay, so you can use void or you can left blank. And a left brace or bracket. Okay, both of them, brace and bracket, are synonyms in English. And the curly bracket is this thing. Okay, begins the body of the every function. Okay, and of course this facing to the left is the ends the function. All right. And then each line is a C statement. Don't use line anymore because the C statements can long multiple lines as well. So we have the function printf in our example with parentheses. We understand it's function. When you need the function, you can call the function with providing the parameters. I don't want to use the arguments because of some reason you are gonna learn C++. It's gonna be confusing otherwise. For the moment, please use only the parameter. Don't use the argument for the moment. One day you will understand the difference. Today I will not explain, of course. Okay. So we talk about the string. What is a string? Anything between double quotation mark. If it is something, the string, so you cannot change that in double quotes. You are gonna put everything in between onto the screen. Okay. So we said that every C statement with ends up with a semicolon. And by the way, for example, we said that statement, you cannot say sentence. Do you understand the difference? You cannot say C sentence, never and ever. Nobody will understand what you are talking. It is C statement. These are the things that I am putting on yellow color. These are the terms. You have to memorize and use it, not because of me. But in the world, the Chinese, the Indians, the Americans, whatever the programmer language is, they all say that C statement. You never heard C sentence or C phrase. You never hear. You will never be hearing that. Okay, so you have to memorize this, not for the sake of helping me. It's helping yourself. Everybody in the world use that. Okay, so you cannot use synonyms in English. You cannot say this line is a C statement. Okay, you can say C statement, but you cannot say, okay, this line is a C sentence. You cannot say this. It's very important. You have to understand that that's the terminology. It's not a random English word. It's not like that. So when I ask, what is that? You cannot say that it is a line. No, you have to say that it is C statement. In an interview, after graduation, before starting a job, in an interview, they will ask you several questions to understand your knowledge about computer engineering topics. If you say somewhere, C sentence, forget it. Forget it. Okay, I think I am clear, right? Everybody understands what I am talking? Okay, please try to memorize and use it. Otherwise, in an interview, in talking with your other friends, or in talking with software team members, they will laugh at you. They will make fun of you. Okay, it's not professional. You have to use these words, this terminology. All right. So the main is a function returns an integer. I will come to this point later. Now I will ask and you will reply because we are running out of time. Again, but I will go very fast. Okay, what is that part? Header comment. Okay. Okay, what's that part? Preprocessing directive. What is that part? That part. Function header. Bravo. What is all that part? Function body. Bravo. Okay. Now, what is that part together? That part. A statement. Bravo. How do you understand it is a statement? Because ending with a semicolon. Bravo. So what is a printf or scanf? You never seen before. What is a scanf here? Scanf is a function. Why? Because there is a parenthesis immediately after it. Okay. Bravo. And now, what is integer? Int. What's int? Int is not a variable. Int is an integer. What is integer? A number without a decimal point. Bravo. Now, let me move on something. What is value 1, value 2, and product? Bravo. Variables. Actually, they are the name of the variables. Remember last week we have the box, huh? And name of a box. So box symbolizes as a variable. And there is there, for example, value 1 is the name of that box. Remember? And box has a value. Remember that we have a value inside it. For example, 3 is the value of the box. Okay. So how many variables we have here? How many variables we have here? 3. Bravo. So what we called the whole statement here? The whole statement. The whole statement. Okay, I will put, because this is the first time I am talking about this part, the whole part, the statement is called variable declaration. Declaration. Okay, this is the variable declaration statement. Variable declaration. You can memorize that. There are the variables and the declaration. Declaration means we are declared to the compiler. We are gonna use 3 variables. And what we are gonna also say, we are gonna give the names of the variables. You see that to the compiler. We are saying that this name is value 1, the name of this value 2, and that's the name of the product. Okay, the names. So in the variable declaration, we say how many variables and what are their names. What more we are talking about to the or information we are giving to the compiler? Look. So what we are gonna put the inside of that box? What we are gonna put inside the that box? It's a int. Int means integer. Integer means that there is no decimal point in the number. And actually int is a one of the data types. Data type. What data types we see so far? We see one integer, and second we see a string. I'm sorry, string. Okay, so data type means that type of the data. So far we see int, integer, and string. Okay, for the moment. For the strings, you are gonna see in the 114 courses. Okay, not here, but I just mentioned right now. So we are gonna, in the variable declaration, we put the data type and the variable names. Do you understand all of them? Okay, so in the variable declaration, this is called variable declaration, we provide the data type, we provide the variable names by using the semicolons. At the end, we put the, by using the comma, and at the end, we put the semicolon. Okay, so that is called variable declaration. All right, so that's a statement or function call, right? It's a function call. Also, this is another function call. And what is that? What is that? Yes, it's kind of a process maybe, but it, in the process is in the flowchart concept. It's not C concept. Okay. It's still statement, but what kind of a statement? It's not variable. This is variable, this is variable, this is, but these are not variables. Remember? Anybody remembers last week? Assignment. Remember assignment last week? Anybody remembers last week assignment? Remember? This is the assignment symbol. Remember last week assignment? So what we are gonna doing here? Anybody tell me? So we are multiplying value 1 by value 2. Is that right? We are multiplying value 1 times value 2. Is that right? No. We are multiplying the value of 1, the value of value 1 variable with the value of value 2 variable. Remember here, for example, it's 3. We are not multiplying V1 with V2. We are multiplying the V1 value, which is 3, with the value 2, whatever the value is. Okay. And finding the answer, for example, let's say find 8, then we are assigning 8 to the product variable. So it means that we are overwriting the value to the product variable. Remember last week? Any problem so far? So that's called assignment. Okay. So that's called function call again, because you see that. Okay, in flowchart, actually this printf is what? How can we show this printf in flowchart? Which symbol? So which symbol, Boray? Yes, parallelogram. So that's a parallelogram. And this printf also parallelogram. This product, how can I symbolize? With what? You said that it's process. Rectangle. Bravo, rectangle. For that scanf, scanf is a output to the screen. Output to the screen. I will teach you in 2 weeks later. So still with rectangle or parallelogram. Parallelogram, because it's output. And this variable declaration, how can I show it? Is the input output? This input, is that input output? No, rectangle. It's a process. Do you understand how I just make the these flow charts and with the real code? So you are gonna look at this code, flow chart. Here are the symbols. You can write this in the feature 2 weeks later. You are gonna do this 2 weeks later. Fine. All right. So, okay. So for the moment, I will stop these tokens. Okay, here. Actually, I already talked about all these. Thank you for listening. See you next week. Bye-bye.